First, I want to thank the organizers for inviting me and giving me the opportunity to talk. It's a pleasure and honor to do it on the occasion of the 60th birthday of Matthias. We met often, I think. We interacted and inspired. At least you inspired me, I think. I guess I wanted to do things often differently, but nevertheless, there was a lot of inspiration. Now, I want to talk on a very classical problem, very, very simple-minded question. Well, look at the quadratic Defries equation. Equal to zero, so the typical things are x and t are real numbers. Then you prescribe initial data, u of 0x is equal to u0, and u0 is a bump function of size epsilon. So, what can you say about the behavior?
What? A bump of size epsilon, that just refers to horizontal or vertical size?
It refers to a vertical size, there is scaling involved. I'm going to be more precise later. I'm not actually not working with a bump function with some norms, but I hope that this will become clear then later on. But the question is simply, what can you say about large times? The behavior at large time, what can you say? Well, this is a classical topic, which is also currently active. So I have to say a few things here. Well, the first maybe is the interest, that different reasons for being interested in a quadratic Defries equation. One of them is that it's a sort of universal equation. It's a universal asymptotic equation. So when you look at, and this was a motivation for me and my co-workers, which I'm going to mention later on, if you look at, let's say, water waves, one-dimensional water waves with a finite bottom, then this is one of the instances in which the quadratic Defries equation occurs as asymptotic equation. So if you want to understand the large time behavior there, maybe we should first look at the large time behavior for quadratic Defries. Then, of course, one also often looks first at well-posedness. It's well-posed, and it's as good as it could possibly be. It's well-posed in H minus 1. This is a work by Killip and Vishan, which occurred this year in the Annals, and of course there have been many more things in the literature with many famous names on well-posedness for quadratic Defries. But somehow the well-posedness question is quite good. Here you cannot construct solutions by iteration, but when you construct solutions by iteration, then you get some. You can easily use the conserved quantities, the L2 norm, to get, this was then Bourguin, to get the global existence. Was it Bourguin in this case? But the catch, if you do prove well-posedness by iteration, is that you get very little control over the behavior at large times. So you lose all the control over large time behavior, because if you look at differences, you catch constants, multiplicative constants, you get a control, only exponential control for differences in time. So it doesn't give any good information for large time. But there's another structure. This is the inverse scattering. Okay. Interesting. Okay. Stops when it goes up. There is the inverse scattering. Inverse scattering transform. And the inverse scattering transform somehow is a method to linearize and it gives precise formulas. And this, maybe I should put some names to that. One of the first things is Aplowitz and Siegel for large times. There's some work by Deift, Venikidis, maybe 20 years ago, and Chu, and others who try to understand this. So the formulas of inverse scattering, the inverse scattering transform, certainly have all you know, want to know about the asymptotics in them, but it's not so easy to get it out of them. It's not my topic, but I guess this is not, people from inverse scattering tell me that this is not rigorous, and this is somehow not, only gives partial information, and this is about what is there. Then maybe the fourth point is, whenever you talk about global behavior of dispersive equations, then there is the soliton resolution conjecture, which without the smallness for localized data tells you that you should expect a decomposition into solitons and something scattering. And there is even a book on that by Schur in 84, which says that without the smallness, you get solitons plus something which is O of t to the minus 1/2. The problem here is that this information is for some reasons not particularly precise, and I want to tell you a bit about how one get more precise information. Now, a very rough version of the theorem I'm presenting is the following. With Ephraim so it's the same estimates. So you have the linear estimates I'm going to be more precise later up to some t which is small compared to epsilon to the minus 3. Epsilon being the size here. And okay, so this is these are the linear estimates of the linear equation. Now I want to draw a picture. So here we have t. Here we have x, and then there is a curve in here, which is t is equal to x to the t is equal to x cube. So this is the scaling, or maybe I should put it better, different x. X equal to plus or minus t to the 1/3. Maybe that's a better way of thinking about it. So then there is the time, there's one time, which is epsilon to the minus 2. So this is the regime of the Picard iteration. This is where you get information by Picard, by the, not the small localized data. And our results go up to epsilon to the minus 3. And then there are different regimes. There is something which I would call the elliptic regime. Elliptic here. Then this is the self-similar. And this is something which I call, would call scattering. Scattering regime here to the left. So now maybe I should come back here. You asked me about what I mean by the bump. I don't want to give a definition, but think of epsilon times the Dirac measure at zero. which is a very nice bump, but it's not so smooth, but it is it is allowed here. And then the question is, what do you expect, what do you know about this very specific solution? Then you can set epsilon equal to 1 by scaling. So this is a very, very specific question. Now, I want to continue this picture further up, but since I'm not as tall to use this blackboard, I have to, it's not possible to use all. I don't know. So, well, then this is a self-similar picture, so I want to draw it somehow up here. Now we have the time epsilon to the minus 3 here. And the question, first question then is, before I get to technical parts, what about this time scale epsilon to the minus 3? Is it natural? And it is, since after that the behavior changes. So if you look at what we have here, then here we have the behavior, the expected behavior, and I think this is also known, is t to the minus 1/3, and there are self-similar solutions. There are self-similar solutions, and this is the decay which you expect from scaling in the self-similar region. Then at exactly at this time scale, for small data, there you have to expect, and this is also known, there are solitons. There's one soliton, depending on the sign. If epsilon is negative, well, or minus epsilon delta, there's a soliton coming out here. There is a certain mechanism. I mean, the driving mechanism here is the Burger mechanism, which means that in this regime, this third time derivative becomes not irrelevant, but this becomes more dominant in this part, and that pushes the solution either to the left or to the right. If it pushes the solution to the right, it's going to lead to the separation of a soliton. If it pushes it to the left, it leads to this different, this stronger self-similar decay. I mean, the linear decay would be t to the minus 1/3, and here there's stronger decay, which is a nonlinear effect. And here there's modified scattering, and according to Aplowitz and Dive, to Aplowitz and Siegel, there is a certain regime, there's a logarithmic deviation of that with a dispersionless shock. So this picture, this global picture, is pretty clear how it should look like. I mean, it's called dispersionless shock by Aplowitz and Siegel, so I don't want to explain why it's a shock. I don't understand it, but so there is a sort of complete picture, but it's far from being proven. What Aplowitz and Siegel do is they prove this sort of behavior in the asymptotic regions, but not in a uniform way, not with uniform constants and so on. And also Deift and Vinakidis and Chu, they get part of the picture. So what we want to do, what I want to explain is the behavior up to here. We want to get further, but there's a natural reason to first look at this case. Now, how can one understand this? Well, if we want to do something like that, maybe we should first look at the linear case. So we look at ut plus uxxx is equal to 0. In that case, we get the solution to the initial value problem by the convolution by an Airy function. So we have to convolve with respect to x with t to the normalization constants, which I'm going to ignore, the Airy function x divided by t to the minus 1 over 3. So if you have size epsilon, you get decay epsilon t to the minus 1 over 3. This is not compatible with the self-similar region, where you can see that at this time scale, something else has to happen. Now, how does the Airy function look like? So here we have x. Yeah, I'm going to draw the Airy function It's not an explicit function, but the asymptotics are very well known and variation at certain points. So there's faster than exponential decay here, then there's a bump here, and then it starts to oscillate, and the oscillations get faster and faster, and the envelope behaves like x to the minus 1 over 4. And this theorem says that, well, you get estimates for the nonlinear problem up to this time scale, which are motivated by the estimates of the derivatives and the absolute value here. And here you convolve for something, so you have to be more careful on this side. Now, this argument is easy, Wolf's looking at the Airy function, but it has a disadvantage that it's not so clear how to transfer it to a nonlinear problem. So let's get a more complicated argument for that. Still, in the context of the linear equation, we look at an operator. L is equal to multiplication minus 3 times t times dx squared. Oh. Okay, the second derivative whatsoever. And then, if you write v is equal to lu, and if u satisfies the linear equation, then you get vt plus vxxx is equal to 0. So this commutes with the equation, similar to the x derivative, and that is the generator of the scaling of this problem. So, well, then one can also do a Fourier transform. This equation generates is a multiplication by something of modulus 1 on the Fourier side. So if you take some initial data, we assume the initial data is in, now it gets complicated, the minus 1/2 homogeneous space to infinity. And what we assume is that x times u0 is in h 1/2, the homogeneous space. If you have this information, then this implies that u of t is in this space, and l u is in this space, because they are defined on the Fourier side by a multiplication, so these norms are constant. Now, once you have that, then there is a trick. There are the Kleinermann-Sobolev inequalities. Kleinermann-Sobolev inequalities, in order to write them in this context, I wanted to introduce the notion, this Japanese bracket, which in my case is going to be, there's a t hidden here, that's t to the 1/3 plus x, and then, well, let's see, 2/3 squared, and this to the power 1/2. So this is the scaled Japanese bracket. And then there's the Kleinermann-Sobolev inequality, which says that, you know, I have to make sure that I get the constants, the things right, that t to the 1/4 x to the 1/4 u plus t to the 3/4 x to the minus 1/4 u x, this is less or equal up to a constant, and then we put here u of t in b minus 1/2 infinity 2 plus l u in h 1/2. So this is at fixed t. Now what type, what is the character of this estimate? I mean, once you have that, you get this dispersive decay, and that's exactly what we then prove for the nonlinear equation. Now, this is an estimate. Yeah? Yeah, this was to infinity. This one. Thank you. So, I mean, once you prove this estimate for fixed time, and for, let's say it's scale invariant for t equal to 1, then you get this dispersive decay for the linear Eyre equation. Now, what is the character of this? Well, I want to use the two blackboards, so I have to be careful with it. I shouldn't waste too much time, space here. So, well, what you look at is, you look at an equation, you call what x, what this is, you look at x minus 3, x times u, minus 3 u x x equal to f, and want to get pointwise bounds of u in terms of the sort of Sobolev norms or L2-based norms on f and u. So if x is positive, then this has the same sign as this one, and this is then good, which could be called elliptic. If x is negative on the left-hand side, there's a certain factorization then, and this should be considered as a transport equation. And I don't want to get into the arguments. It's not entirely trivial to prove these estimates, but it's an exercise in ordinary differential equations and these function spaces. Okay. Now, let's go back to the nonlinear problem. And we want to do a similar approach for the nonlinear problem. So we want to the theorem is for the nonlinear problem in a more precise version. So if you assume that this epsilon is a small number, if the initial data in B minus a half dot to infinity plus x u in H homogeneous space, it's important to take the homogeneous spaces for scaling and also in order to avoid some nasty things here. If this is less than epsilon, then this implies the, let me call this less or equal epsilon for t up to this time scale epsilon to the minus 3. And the strategy of the proof is the same. If you sketch the proof, then let's stay with the first step. Well, there's a uniform control. On u of t in and this is, I guess there, and I'm not sure whether I'm complete, this is a consequence of some work with Buckmaster. There are several references in 2015 where we didn't state this estimate, but it's a consequence. Then there is work by Tataru on these things where we again didn't state this estimate, but it's an immediate consequence, and similar to the work by Killip, Vishan, and Chang at about the same time. So we get a uniform estimate here. So this is the easier part. Well, what happens if you apply this operator L? You apply this operator L, now we have a nonlinear problem. The operator L commutes with the linear part, but not with the nonlinear one. So then we would have to look at the linearized equation in order to control V U. Then this leads to looking at a linear equation, linearized equation. But you have to be careful here, we are beyond the setting where the Picard iteration works. So whenever you extend that, you have to expect some problems which you have to deal with. So you have to use something like normal form transforms, hope that resonances are not strong, use modified energies, or something of that type. So you can't expect that this works immediately, and it turns out to better take a nonlinear version of that, to take V equal to LU, and then there is a plus 9TU squared. So this comes from guessing, trying, and seeing whether you get to some place where you can make sense of that and use that. And then if this is V, then we get that VT plus VXXX is equal to 6UVX. And then I can have to look at 3 plus 3V squared. So this is a linear part. And then this is an inhomogeneity for this linear equation. And then it turns out that we can control, the things to do is to control, there's a bootstrap, and we should say that's a bootstrap assumption, which says that this A is bounded by M times epsilon, so that you have it up to a large constant, so M large. That's a bootstrap assumption, then you want to prove that this also holds for a better constant. But under this bootstrap assumption, it turns then out that it's possible to control the linear equation, control linearized equation. And here it's sort of important, where do you want to do that? We want to do that in H dot 1/2. And this is, or maybe in B, sorry, we want to do it in H dot 1/2. And this is a sort of ideal space for that, because that is sort of self-dual. So ignore the inhomogeneity, but we get then, we can control things here. But again, here we have to use some sort of modified energies in order to get rid of resonances, and then estimate the V squared. Again, there are resonances, sorry, there are, maybe I should say some normal forms. You have to get rid of the no resonances, so you can get rid of the, you can transform it to something of some higher order. Now what remains to be done is to complete the argument is with a nonlinear Kleinermann Sobolev inequality. And this can be done, but it's again the same thing. You're beyond the regime of the linear regime, so you have to get rid of some sort of quadratic terms. I said it wrong, there are no resonances at this level. So you have to, but you have to get beyond what you would get if you simply linearize, because then we would be in the Picard regime. For that you have to use normal forms or modified energies at every step, also at the Kleinermann-Sobolev inequality. And then you have to make sure that you can close the whole thing by improving then this M. Okay, so this is maybe what I wanted to say about the proof. Maybe I should say that, I mean, personally, I guess not only I myself find this the question about the large time behavior of Cordovic de Vries independent, interesting in its own right. So it's a very natural question. But we also were looking for tools which then also apply to the water wave problem and to other problems where KdV sits inside this bigger problem. And there is a conceptual, maybe also a conceptual question, which has been motivating me for several things. I mean, if you look at wave propagation, nonlinear wave propagation, then there are some equations which stand out, the nonlinear Schrödinger equation and the Cordovic de Vries equation, because they are somewhat universal asymptotic equations, which you see whenever you look at some nonlinear dispersive equations, wave equations, or whatsoever. Now both the nonlinear Schrödinger equation, one-dimensional, and the Cordovic de Vries equation are integrable. What are the consequences of integrability? Consequence of integrability is that, at least in some function spaces, in some sense, you get a global in time control on solutions, which is difficult to work out, but you have not the problem which you get by the Picard iteration that constants explode. And I guess I'm wondering, looking at this equation since sort of long time, the question, does this have some implications to the original problem you started with? So should you expect that the Cordovic de Vries or nonlinear Schrödinger equation should be in some sense a good approximation, give some good information about the problem beyond these natural time scales when one looks at well-prepared initial data and so on? So there should be something which is more global, and I guess this is something we are after. And maybe, I'm not an expert in that, but maybe one could make a point that if you look at tsunamis, which are supposedly described by Cordovic de Vries, you are in a situation like that. So you're going to see the wave which survives, which is KdV, seems to give information about something in a very complex setting where it might be very difficult to rigorously prove that you get a wave like that with all the noise and all the other things going on in the ocean. Thank you for the attention.
Thank you.